So, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Miguel Palacios. I'm a professor of management at ESCP Europe Business School at the Madrid campus. My area of specialization is innovation and entrepreneurship with a little touch on strategy. And within that, I also work on the energy business. In fact, I have to thank the Hellenic Association of Energy Economics for inviting me to moderate this roundtable, and specifically Kostas Andriosopoulos, who is coming in right now, for inviting me to this conference. Now, we're going to talk about innovation and the role of networks in the energy sector. In fact, up to now, we have talked a lot about oil and gas, about regulation, about energy markets. But at the end of the day, we all want to have the light on, specifically here and everywhere. So if we want to the hospital, we want to have the light on. If we want to go to different places, we want to have the light on. And this deals with the grid, with the network, which is what we are going to talk about now. And in fact, in the network is one of the areas where we have seen more developments in the recent years. Probably the way we interact with the network is going to change fairly soon. People claim that we are on the fourth industrial revolution, so the capabilities of automation and the network may affect the way we interact with electricity. We have talked in the past sessions about prosumers, many elements that we may cover with the speakers today in the roundtable. In fact, when I was reading the CVs of the speakers in the roundtable, I got very impressed, because we have some of the top European experts in the field speaking today. In fact, with no further ado, I will leave the floor to Maher, Executive Officer, Chief Innovation Officer of GE Digital Energy Solutions. By the way, I strongly recommend you to read their CVs on the brochure, because behind the names here, there are very important careers.
Thank you. Thank you for moderating. I will make my best not to let you miss your flight. So I will be speaking about what's going on in Europe and what we are doing at GE as well. So ETIPSET is the Committee of Energy Transition that the European Commission has put in place as a successor of the European Technology Platform Smart Grids. This initiative looks after the objectives 2050, how we decarbonize Europe in 2050. We produced a report in June last year, which presents the convergence between the different energy sources and energy networks, gas, heating, cooling, electricity, and the importance of data, which is fully integrated in the networks across the whole energy system. So Nikos here is the chair of the ETIPSNET. I play the role of the chair of the digital energy group at the ETIPSNET. Speaking about digital, we produced a short and a long report about what are our recommendations for the digitalization of the energy towards 2050. And these are some of the recommendations we have put. We say, yeah, there will be the usage of artificial intelligence and machine learning. Actually, machine learning is not new. It existed since 70 years. But today, if you ask the question to the CIOs, only 4% of them have been deploying AI and machine learning. There is a lot of work to be done. Digital twins and the platforms will play an important role. And what we said is we have to look at the use cases. So the technology itself and the digitalization is not the purpose, it's an enabler. So how these can provide more services that can help the energy system to be improved and provide more value to the customers. We spoke about blockchain and the importance of blockchain peer-to-peer transactions. And then we also spoke about recommendations how to make more favorable regulations for the market, opening the market and giving some space for retail and competitive retail toward the customers and training. And also what's important in our recommendation is the sector coupling. If tomorrow we look at electricity on its own, it's completely wrong. We have to look at electricity and the other energy sources all together holistically. And if tomorrow we look at the energy sector on its own, we are also absolutely wrong. We have to look at the buildings, at the transportation, at the energy and the other sectors. Digital twin was one of the recommendations. It's like a black box you have in a plane. It has the memory and the tracing of all the activities that you do, even from the engineering and construction sector in the manufacturing plants, throughout the operations and the maintenance activities. So we trace all these activities that if you want to know anything about your infrastructure, for example, you would work only on the digital twin, the mirror, the image of your system, and it will tell you what will happen in the future. So one of the examples of the innovations is the blockchain. This is one of the projects we are doing at GE. In Philadelphia, it's an economic zone with four microgrids, and we have created a portal where the tenants can produce renewables and sell to other tenants and make the full payment and transactions peer-to-peer on that economic zone where you have like 30,000 employees who work there. Now, we believe in the importance of innovation, not always in acquisitions, not always by looking outside, but also by using the brains of our people. So we have done a challenge at GE last year in Q2 where we addressed 3,000 people in digital and engineering and research and so on. And we said, look, we have three themes that you see here on the grid, on the storage and energy at the edge. And we say, give us your best ideas that we select the top five winners. We had 1,400 people who visited the portal. We had about 1,000 votes, and we created 30 evaluators. We used a tool we call Genius Link, which is a tool on the market that can manage all the scoring we get. For anyone could vote. And then we have the 30 evaluators also who put their scoring. And then we came to the top five ideas. As you can see, most of them are about flexibility, and a lot of innovation, we believe, is about flexible generation, flexibility on the network, how to predict, for example, the extension as well of the grid, hybrid storage, and then we had also some work as well on the overall optimization of the cost of the grid. Now, we believe that the digitalization and the energy innovations is not only one company who can do everything. We created a group. I initiated that last year. Created a brand called DEX, GE Digital Energy Executive Exchange. And we brought about 50 power companies in the world to come and to exchange around these topics. And we said everything that we will discuss in predictive analytics, in simulations, in digital twins, digital worker, digital inspections, and so on, energy flexibility. Let's keep in mind that the value is what's important at the end. How that can contribute to save cost for you, how that can contribute to provide more outcome or more revenues, or create new business models. Now, one of the examples that we are working on in terms of innovations that was mentioned yesterday and today is the energy efficiency. We believe that no one can have one single solution for energy efficiency that satisfies all countries, all segments. So we created a marketplace called GE Energy Efficiency Services. It's like an Apple store. On that, we host all kinds of apps that comes from startups, very specialized in a given segment, given country. And then we are hosting these startups on that marketplace, sometimes playing a role of intermediation and sometimes bundling these startup technology solutions with our solutions, PPA, storage, and other solutions that we have as well in power, and providing that to commercial industrial customers, 12,000 energy-intensive companies according to the IEA, or to residential customers via utilities. And that model would address the market where the IEA says that there was in 2017 $236 billion investments. We made some calculations in a study at GE. If we save 1% in efficiency in these five sectors, we would save 276 billion over the next 15 years. Now, to finish my speech, energy will change to be more distributed. So rather than having few power plants that you will manage, you will have a few and millions of distributed energy resources. Smart grids will be the answer to that. Transportation will be more integrated. It's going to be electric, and smart transportation solutions combined with the smart grids will have the change. Industry will look always after efficiency, digitalization, and the digital twins will be used everywhere, end to end. And the customers, like in telecom, will be reversing the value chain. They will be influencing a lot of the choices we are making. And we speak a lot about digital customers, not smart customers, because more the technology is powerful, less we require the customers to be smart. And this is how it should be. So in the plane, for example, the pilot is not doing that much. Everything and the complexity is in the pilot, in the cockpit of the plane. And the cities, decarbonized, sustainable cities. And when we speak about sustainable cities, we combine energy, technology, IT, connectivity, and the transportation sector. Thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Maher, for being perfectly on time. And now we have Nicolas Chatziargyriou, sorry for pronouncing your name, chairman of the Hellenic Electricity Distribution Network Operators, HEDNO.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the introduction. And I want to thank the organizers for inviting us to present here about our work in HEDNO. I want to also thank Maher for his very nice talk that was a perfect introduction to what I'm going to speak about. And you will see that my speech is quite a lot influenced by what Maher said, perhaps because we're in the same group and do similar things. So let me start by what I'm going to talk about is to say a few words about the energy market in transition, to speak about the central role of the DSOs. So in fact, I'm speaking in the context of what Maher said, but from a DSO point of view. Then I will end up with some what we do as HEDNO in the last 4 years. So that's perhaps well known, the old model of the one-way flows and the large production that ended up in the customer has changed, and most of the changes happen at the lower part of the network. So we have now new activities, we have flexibility, we have efficiency, we have distributed generation, we have the customer becoming an important figure in all this, we have the rise of the prosumer, who is now producer and consumer, and you have the interdependency between the customer, who is becoming another central actor with the whole environment. And of course, all this brings a more efficient system, more secure, and also lowers costs. So the customer, the citizen, the active customer becomes now a central person in the developments, using the developments in power technology and home automation. So he has a completely new role, completely new perspective on how he manages energy, which is now more flexible and far-reaching. And customers are equipped with choices. They can generate, store, trade their own electricity, and also be involved in energy management, in efficiency, automation, monitoring, and control. Of course, all this assumes that there is already a right regulatory environment in place that provides incentives and helps also the customer be friendly to the system and the environment. And all this brings the what we call digitalization of utilities. There is now a vast amount of information available, vast amount of data available to the DSOs, data that are coming from smart meters or from sensors that are everywhere in the network. All the controllers are now also devices that collect and send data. So this data, if they are used efficiently, they can bring a lot of advantages in the efficiency of the operation of the distribution system operator. They can be used for local balancing of supply and demand. They can be used for preventive maintenance and condition-based maintenance. They can allow automated control, so operation can be improved tremendously. You can have online detection of faults. You can have a much better management or much better monitoring of the system. Customers are much better served. Also, personalized communication is possible. You can have platforms, as Maher said before, that support distributed energy resources and marketplaces and exchange of information, exchange of power. You can have back office automation, field workforce that with mobile access to maps, they can also have advanced educational possibilities, advanced training through digital twins. And a lot of gains for the distribution system operator. And the distribution system operator now is becoming more a data manager, also together with energy. Also, besides moving energy, he's also transporting data. He's in the center of building distributed system platforms that coordinate distributed generation, energy, storage, electric vehicles, and of course, all this has to. All this in collaboration or with the central role of the customers. So that's the environment of how today DSOs operate or at least it's the dream of DSOs in Europe and in most developed countries. So let me say a few words about HEDNO. HEDNO, perhaps just to say that is the distribution system operator of Greece. He provides electricity supply to 7.4 million consumers through medium and low voltage networks, and also operates the high voltage networks in Attica and the islands. He serves, he has a total network length of 237,000 kilometers. This is more or less half and half in medium voltage and low voltage. And also in regarding renewables, more than 70% of the renewable generation is connected to our networks. So we are, our task is to ensure efficient operation, maintenance, development of the network, manage non-interconnected islands, provide unhindered access to all network users, and also operate smoothly the electricity supply market, I mean, help in operating the smooth electricity market. So just our strategy is to use technologies and smart grids, and our goal is to modernize our distribution network. And our investment plan foresees a total budget of 200 million per year annually and includes projects for reinforcing and modernizing the distribution grid. This is organized in 12 plus one smart projects, so they are dealing with modernization of our control centers and our automation and monitoring of the system. Also, GIS systems for better planning, a new based customer service system, also upgrade our planning. Quite a lot of effort is devoted to islands. Also to reorganize the supply chain and provide the informatics database integrating all the information. And I perhaps spend a few words for our perhaps best and worst project. The best project, I would say, is our Smart Islands project. What we do here is we want to operate islands with a very high penetration of renewables, which means more than 60%. And in fact, there is a law in Greece that prescribes the implementation of smart islands. We have already there are three islands selected, Astypalea, Symi, and Castellorizo. And the idea is to realize this project by tenders that will be held by the regulator, by RAE. And what we want to do is to have storage units together with renewable energies to take over more of the operation of the system. And in fact, we have run several studies showing that it is possible and perfectly secure to run systems with more than 60% of renewable penetration, reducing costs, ensuring reliability, and keeping security of supply. And the IRRs are more than 11%. Now I'm coming to our worst project. This is the automatic meter reading of low voltage customers. This is a very long and painful story. It started many years ago. We started with a pilot project that is still in the courts for the last, I don't remember, 5 years, with no, 4 years, with no really hope to continue. And we have already developed a business model for the rollout since the spring of 2017 that still is not known what how it will continue. Recently, we heard that PPC is, although it rejected our plan, it's now thinking of it again. So this is a project that I would say is perhaps our worst project. And all these projects will bring us to the first big step towards the smart grid area, era. By 2021, these projects are expected to continue. I must say most of them are very well on track. They're moving fast. And then we have new ideas, new technologies that we are already thinking and planning, EVs, cybersecurity, drones, blockchain, new services, interactive markets, energy communities. We have we are trying to play a role in energy communities, big data, Internet of Things. And we are moving there. One of our big steps there is to the Switch On Innovation Lab that has been perhaps is one of the first innovation labs for energy in Greece. It's for sure the first in Greece and one of the first in Europe. And the idea was to support young engineers, young groups of industry experts to develop and apply new technologies and to let them experiment or apply them on our networks. And so they provide to them new, so they develop new business model, new business cases. And in fact, we had more than 57 proposals were submitted in response to our call. And these were covering all the variety of big data, data analytics, blockchain, peer-to-peer, platforms, image processing, image recognition, drones, Internet of Things, virtual reality, augmented reality, artificial intelligence, and also deep learning. And from that, on the 5th of February, 5 proposals were selected from a committee of within HEDNO. And now we are already, these groups, the 5 selected groups, are working on developing further the ideas, building prototypes that will be installed in our networks. And they will probably provide very useful technology for us and very nice opportunities for these young people. So that completes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Nicolas, for presenting first the view of the end user and then the view of the TSO. That was, as you said, completely complementary to Maher's presentation on technologies. So now we have Harry Vovos, Head of Corporate and Investment Banking, National Bank of Greece. I guess that we're going to talk about money.
Thank you, Miguel. Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank the Hellenic Association of Energy Economics and Mr. Andriusopoulos for the productive conference, as well as the opportunity to share a few thoughts with the esteemed participants. The subject of our panel discussion picture the future of energy networks, which is already very close. I would dare to say it is already here. The expected contribution of the next generation networks to sustainability, growth, and overall improved quality of life is almost certain. I will try to add a financing perspective to our discussion providing a couple of figures first. The blunt amount of the investment required to upgrade the existing European Union energy infrastructure, as well as develop the next generation networks, is remarkable. About 140 billion of investments in electricity networks, and at least 70 billion in gas. And this is according to the European Union's Innovation and Networks Executive Agency. Furthermore, according to the Greek National Energy Plan for the next decade, targets for energy investments exceed 30 billion by 2030, and approximately 40% relates to directly or indirectly to the energy networks. These figures are obviously music to the ears of the financing community and attract the focus of investors, the banking sector, the international financing institutions, the capital markets, and the rest of the participants in the financing ecosystem. Undoubtedly, there is strong credit appetite for investments in networks, and these enjoy priority access to financial resources. So availability of funds is not an issue, even in countries like Greece, where the financial system is recovering from challenging times. Negatively, and within our role as the leading bank in Greece, National Bank of Greece recently reconfirmed this strategic role and its trust to the energy networks by solely financing with more than 350 million euros the acquisition of the Hellenic gas system transmission operator. Going beyond the obvious, though, the financial institutions have the responsibility to take our contribution to the next level. We have to play a more active role aiming to facilitate and accelerate the network's transition, leverage not only the financial resources available, but also a more proactive mindset with fit-for-purpose products and services fitting to the ecosystem that our previous speakers described. As energy networks move from the traditional one-way power system to the smart, flexible energy system within a circular economy, similarly, our financing tools, and most importantly, our mindset as financiers, should be transitioning from the traditional financing options towards a more integrated toolkit addressing the entire ecosystem and the next generation networks that this will create. An ecosystem that is diverse and includes indicatively the prosumers, the producers, consumers, the various suppliers of equipment and technology, the power generators, the distributions, all interacting into a very dynamic way. The fit-for-purpose financing toolkit should be able to cover the whole spectrum of participant needs, from corporate to retail, facilitating and accelerating the network development and the prosumer access and activation. But how can we, as institutions, leverage our role to this potential facilitator, accelerator within this framework? And this is also a question to our panel here. All the participants are esteemed specialists with an active role in shaping the future we discussed today. So the question, my question is, how common is for banks and other financing institutions to join your work groups, particularly at an early stage, particularly where the subject is innovation that may face financial barriers, both at the early stage, but also when it should prove it is bankable and financeable at the commercialization stage? Well, I would leave this for discussion later. My brief message is there is definitely strong supply of funding for the energy infrastructure from a plethora of sources. But this alone will not guarantee accelerated deployment and successful transition to the next generation. What will be helpful is adopting an ecosystem approach from a financing angle, fostering a closer collaboration among the various stakeholders and the financing community, ensuring the best allocation of financial resources, and facilitating the value creation that Maher also mentioned across the chain, and the design early in the process of fit-for-purpose toolkits for products and services. NBG, as the leading energy bank in Greece, has earmarked approximately 2 billion euros of resources for energy sector related financings in the medium term. We are committed and have the expertise to deploy this with the right mindset. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your presentation and for clearly indicating that the banking sector wants to be involved from the beginning in this development. Last but not least, we have Thomas Nikolakakis, Associate Analyst at the Energy Systems Modeling IITC, IRENA.
Firstly, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to this wonderful event. I represent IRENA, which is an international organization supported by more than 160 countries around the world. Greece is one of these countries. The mandate of our organization is to promote the adoption of all types of renewables. And one type of work that we do is to support member countries with analysis and tools, and more specifically what we call solar and wind integration studies, which have a goal to help countries assess the impacts of solar and wind integration into system operations, into long-term investment planning, and into system stability. And the reason why IRENA is interested in integration of solar and wind resources is because in order to decarbonize our energy system, we need to rely heavily on solar and wind power. In order to keep up on track with the goals of the Paris Agreement, based on IRENA calculations, around 86% of total electricity demand by 2050 will be supplied by renewable energy sources, and the great majority of this portion will be coming from solar and wind power. Now, based on global experience, integration, high shares of solar and wind power are technically possible. Denmark, parts of Australia and Ireland are great examples of countries that have achieved very high shares of renewables. But what we have learned from these countries is that we need to strengthen and enhance what we call the system flexibility to manage this. In simplified terms, system flexibility is our power system's ability to kind of use its physical assets within an existing regulatory framework to balance supply and demand at all times. Now, the thing is that integration of solar and wind power makes the process of balancing supply and demand more challenging. And I don't want to get into the details of this, but what I would like to say is that when we integrate these sources, we add variability into our system, and then we have to cycle our existing assets much more. An additional thing is that we add much more uncertainty into the system, which means, like, if our system operator has to procure the commitment of units of dispatchable units the day before, they made some forecast of next day net demand, now they need to account of uncertainty related to VRE, like solar and wind forecasting, and there is high possibility for errors there, and that we need to incorporate mechanisms that ensure the reliable operation of our power systems. Now, in the past, flexibility was synonymous to supply side generation. If we needed flexibility, we would invest to fast units like gas turbines and hydro generation. But if we want to actually decarbonize our energy system, we'll need to harness flexibility in all parts of our energy system, from flexible generation to stronger transmission and distribution networks, more flexible demand and energy storage. And I would like to focus on more flexible demand because this is something more, goes more than what we usually take as granted, like demand-side management in the form of interruptible loads. Other forms, like there's much more potential on flexible demand, as in the case of electrifying heat, like power to heat. And there are cases in our energy system where or parts of our energy system that cannot be reached with a cable, as in the case of the transport sector, or specific processes in the industry, where in the future, when we have a lot of production from solar and wind resources, we can use some of this energy to produce hydrogen and use hydrogen as a fuel and decarbonize the power sector. Now, IRENA, because gives a lot of focus on the issue of flexibility, has last year we published two reports on that issue. One report focuses on the planning aspects and modeling tools, but then we also published the landscape innovation report, where we categorize current trends in the power sector and measures for innovations for flexibility. And we observe three trends in the power sector. One is decentralization. We see large units being currently large, like inflexible generation units, being replaced by smaller, more flexible units and small renewable energy distributed sources. We see electrification, like the global fleet of electric vehicles is growing. However, if these loads are not managed, they can become high capacity, low energy, and create issues in the distribution network. The good news is that these technologies can store energy, like electric vehicles are like batteries, moving batteries, and we can manage these loads if the customers accept that their time of use is not solely their own decision. And thirdly, we see another trend, digitalization, which is what we need to manage the complexity and added into our energy system from electrification and decentralization. So we have digital technologies where we can use to control customer energy use trends, loads, and system elements, and optimize system operations on real time. And we also categorize what are the possible measures we can take to enhance system flexibility to integrate renewables. One is we can use existing technologies, and these are the technologies I have been discussing so far: more flexible generation, stronger transmission, including like super grids and mini grids and smart grids. We need more flexible demand, as I said before, and energy storage either in the form of utility scale or behind the meter or EVs. Another aspect that is detrimental to system flexibility is market design. Because in order to capture the temporal and spatial impacts of solar and wind power into power systems, we need to create appropriate markets that enhance flexibility and remunerate the technologies that can support the grid. So for example, if we want to minimize the impacts of the spatial granularity of solar and wind power, we need to create nodal and solar pricing to capture effects like energy congestion, electricity congestion, and like promote investments on the system, at the parts of the system where really, really need it. And for example, we want to capture the impacts of temporal flexibility, we need to create real-time and intraday markets, as another example. And another group of innovations is system operation, and improving system operations is a very actual, very cheap and a very efficient way to integrate renewables, and this is what countries are usually doing first. And one thing of improving our operation is, using advanced solar and wind forecasting techniques to incorporate these technologies into our energy markets. And the last group is like existing business models like blockchain, peer-to-peer trading, and so on. I'm not planning to use the full 10 slide package. I was planning to stop here and maybe finish. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Thomas, for providing a more research-oriented approach. So what we're going to do is I'm going to ask some questions to the panel, and then we'll open it up for questions from the audience. So given the comment of Thomas that we have a lot of more wind and solar being implemented. Well, the question is, what is the limit? Are we capable of managing it from a TCSO perspective? How do we see it? Do we have the technological capabilities to handle all this variability? And do we have the funding to implement all those changes that we need? Because we saw many players thinking about wind. We saw the European Commission, wind and solar pressing due to carbon emissions towards this technology. So how do you see it? How do you see the immediate future? And I don't know who wants to take the question. I'm open.
Yeah, I think a lot of innovations and the number of 140 billion, which was presented about like smart grids investments, for example, they are related to making, for instance, the network stable. Of course, if we have tomorrow 40%, 50% of renewables and distributed energy resources connected on the networks, we will have some issues. And this is why we develop a lot of models that can predict what will be the output of renewables during the night, during the day, at a given time, considering the condition of the weather and considering other factors as well, that we know at the end from where we should get the energy resources output, from central generation or from distributed, to provide to the customers what is, you know, the cheapest, the cleanest, and the closest energy to the customer at the end. So the role of the data scientist and the modeling is key here, and this is why more every utility, every power company, every network company is hiring a lot of data scientists, is to develop or adapt existing models in this area.
Okay, the 2050 ETIPS net vision foresees operation of the systems with almost 100% renewables. Of course, we don't speak about 100% of variable renewables, but so a large, some extent of it will be given by fuels that are synthetic fuels, or you have power to gas and other technologies that provide some type of fixed controllable energy. But still, renewables also are not totally uncontrollable. There is today a lot of work being done, first in forecasting, and also now you, thanks to power electronics, you can control, at least keep the energy, the power produced by renewables at a controllable level, not 100% because you can't blow more, but at least you can control the output at quite a great extent. And then that's why you say that load flexibility and other flexibility technologies are important to balance these renewables. In the past, generation used to follow load. Now say that load follows generation, which means that you ask the consumer to be flexible, to be able to adjust his consumption, at least non-critical consumption, to the available resources. So although we are not still there, 100%, we are moving towards there, and I think by 2050, if not earlier, we'll be able to operate systems with very, very high penetration of renewables. And in fact, islands, and I saw some examples, are very good first study cases, some pilot living labs where you can experiment with these technologies. And this is what we are trying to do in HEDNO.
Well, I understand that you accept my comment on financing. Well, the funds are there, as I described earlier in my short speech. The issue is how we approach the whole thing, and we need to move towards the ecosystem-based financing across the cycle to deploy the available funds and the credit appetite that exists, you know, for energy investments, so that, first of all, you ensure that you deploy the resources to the best, with the best outcome on value creation, okay? and also ensure that you optimize. What do we mean by funding? What do we mean by funding? Funding is needed where in this value chain? What is the best way to deploy funding? You can deploy it from the one side, you can deploy it from the supplier side, you can deploy it with many products, okay? So the issue is that all that need to take place, this discussion needs to take place with the financiers at an earlier stage of your design, okay? Because in the beautiful world of engineers that I really envy, okay, as a poor economist, the reality is that many things, you know, could have been accelerated if the financing guys had put a couple of ideas earlier in the design, okay? But the funding is certainly there.
Thank you. To answer your question, do we have the technical capability to get into very high shares of variable renewables? Well, definitely we do. Is it easier to do it in a large power system than a smaller power system? If you want to run a small isolated grid in 100% renewables, is easier. Can you run a big country in the 100% renewables? Is not as easy because there are some technical reasons like the inertia you need in a system and the risk of a blackout, which has greater impact on the local economy. Now, what is the limit for renewables? It depends on every power system. Every power system is different, and it includes, firstly, on what is the existing flexibility it has. A system that has existing flexibility should focus on cheap ways to unlock it, and then in the longer term plan for investments, because you want to do it in the least cost way. So we have countries like Denmark that they have achieved shares of renewables to 53%, and then we have, for example, China, when they were curtailing a lot of energy but with a very low share of renewables, like variable, like only 5%. The Chinese power system is much larger, but then there are much more issues there because they didn't plan for system flexibility ahead of time, and they kind of based the growth of an economy on inflexible coal generation. So I'm saying this to make a point that there is no single answer to this. Every power system is different.
Well, thank you very much. So let me build a little bit on the last comment, because I've heard some people claim that we can go on 100% renewables very fast. And let me be provocative here. So there are, and in fact, I think the first two speakers, Maher and Nicolas, are doing something very interesting, which is defined as open innovation, which is they run contests and they're looking outside of their organizations for ideas and solutions to some of their problems. So I was listening to the CEO of a startup in Germany who has 30,000, 40,000 clients now a day. It's a startup that sells batteries, of course. He obviously argues for his business, and he manages through smart meters. The name of the startup is Sonnen, but you could think in Tesla. Tesla has been mentioned several times here. So then the trick, the question, let me get to the question, is do you see new players disrupting your roles? So do you see, I see that you're spotting the markets through the open innovation initiatives. If you look at the newspaper industry, it's been disrupted, encyclopedia industry, it's been disrupted, the banking industry is being disrupted. Do you see your industries being disrupted by these little startups, little players, prosumer movements, players from outside the industry?
Yeah, everybody knows the Kodak and Nokia and what happened to the companies that were the leaders and front runners in the past. So if you don't anticipate the future, you might be dead one day. So first of all, Sonnen, they are in the batteries business for residential customers. and they have developed something interesting, which is the collection of the data from the batteries they installed at home. And with the data they are gathering, they provide also additional services to the households. So GE Ventures was an investor in Sonnen, among other investors. And we have made, I can tell you, we have made an excellent exit by selling Sonnen to Shell. Now, the people are saying there is no more value or innovation or investment we need to do except in data and digital. I'm a digital guy, but I can tell you we should still invest in industrial technologies. And if we invest in industrial technologies like Sonnen did in batteries and data, that's extremely powerful. Now, to avoid having our role disrupted, take the one of the last slides which I presented, we have to work with startups. We work, and the peers of GE work with startups, because we are not fast enough, we are not agile enough to develop quickly what the market needs. We have, all the big groups have big problems of reorganization, whether it's Microsoft, Tesla, GE, and so on. We spend a lot of time on internal, you know, matrix organizations and so on, and the startups are very agile. So to avoid being disrupted by the others, we have to anticipate and we have to work with startups in a model which is very open, invest in them, and if we don't invest in them, partner with them as well. And there will be players who are only in services, there will be players who go into your machines and so on and provide AI and machine learning. We have to accept it. And if you want to be agile like them, we have to partner with them, or we have to spin off and create businesses that are more agile than the traditional business we have.
So I think, well, we'll have one last person answer. But
yeah, because I have a completely different view from Maher. Maher is from the industrial position. I have my views from the operator position. So as DSO, I would say that we are in a unique or perhaps in a different situation, because we are a monopolistic business, and this monopolistic business, of course, under regulation, and rightly so. But our primary aim is not to make money as Maher, but to serve the society, to serve the customer. So as such, of course, we welcome any technology, any disruption that would make the life of the customer, the life of the citizen, better, more secure, more luminant, everything. So our role is to welcome innovation and encourage innovation so customers or the society is served better by us. In fact, many of the new technologies are disruptive for our business. If you have, for instance, distributed generation, since generation is close to load, to consumption, flows in the network are reducing. And to make our money from flows. And to make our money from building wires. Smart grids mean you don't build wires, but you solve this problems with smart solutions. So in a way, smartness is disruptive for our business. But still, we wholeheartedly support smart grids and smart networks because this will make the life of the citizen better. So this is our role.
So thank you very much. I think we have very, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have very unusual people here sitting and exceptional people, very open to innovation and to collaborating with outside partners. This is an example of getting their organizations prepared for the future. Now I open it up for questions to the audience.
So first of all, thank you for these presentations, because now we have a good image of where we should go. I mean, but I think that there is a question behind this is, isn't there an issue of scheduling? Because there are many technologies involved, many development to be made, and probably there are some priorities, maybe to reach some steps. I mean, you first of all, you need to achieve certain goals, and it should be implemented, what you presented, the perfect system, the ideal system that was kind of presented by all of you. There are different steps, and what are the priorities? That's my first question. And behind this question, there is another one. it will be a challenge also for historical players. And don't you feel that there is a risk that these players might kind of be an obstacle to the progression towards this smart type of system which you have described?
I can take it quickly. So the due diligence is extremely important. So fixing the priorities. So I was speaking with the CEO of one power company a week ago, and his nightmare is to find out where to invest with the help of chief digital officer, for example, where to invest to make big impact, first of all on his organization and his processes, and second is on his business with the customers. This is the big nightmare. Last year I was at the Euroelectric and I was speaking with Starazzi, the CEO of Enel. He said, we have fantastic people, fantastic teams. They bring me opportunities everywhere, digitalization, renewables and everything. My problem is I need a third party, an advisor from outside who tells me where the priority is. So I need to work with an advisor, with you maybe guys, or an advisor from outside who tell me what my people are saying, what's important and what's not important, I need to drop. It's very easy to say everything is interesting, it's very difficult to drop things, yeah. Right? We are all tempted to say, okay, let me do this, let me do that. So we have to run a due diligence. This is what the strategic and the innovation roles are very important. And we have to apply exactly what the banks, for example, apply, or the venture capitalists, in terms of evaluating things internally to fix the priorities. There are techniques, design thinking. For example, Shell, other power companies, we used, and I worked with these companies before, we used to run design thinking sessions to select what are the most important opportunities and then put them on a quadrant. What is easy to implement and what's the most rewarding in terms of financial return. And the ones that are on the top right are the ones you would start with, for which you put a budget and you execute on them. So the design thinking you used everywhere today, and I recommend that as the beginning of the thinking, then you build the business case, then you evaluate the millions. We have created a database called Value Management Office. We have defined 220 KPIs, and we calculate everything before we do any digital energy project, for example, for us or for any customer.
Any more questions? So, yeah, you can respond. Yeah. I would like to respond to our bank. So, of course, banking money is very important for realizing all this transition. In fact, there is a lot of funds needed to change this paradigm from the old system to the new system. And it's true that in our discussions in, for instance, NetIPSnet, we don't have people from representing the financial sector. No? And perhaps that's a good idea. We never thought of that. And so it's true that mostly engineers think of how the system should look like in 2050 according to our perceptions. But again, now it's the right moment that we have reached the vision. This, now we are working on the intermediate steps how to realize this vision. And now it's the right time to come into public private partnerships with European money and also with private funding from the banks or other financial sectors to see how we will realize that. And the Commission already has in mind this type of partnerships. So there is still a very bright future to start implementing these ideas of joining forces to see how we can realize this vision. I mean, as long as you agree with this vision, but this vision is more or less, I think, quite clear at the moment.
I can add, also the banks, I was working with the Société Générale, for example, the banks have created teams called Positive Finance or Positive Impact. So they believe more and more to develop their business, they have to think one of the targets of the objective of the SDGs. They have to think socioeconomic benefits, not economic benefits only, but socioeconomic benefits for Africa and for other regions. And they believe by doing this, their business will develop more sustainability than just being short-term, classical banking, you know, financial return.
So will this, with this, we are, in fact, a little bit ahead of the initial schedule, but behind of time, because we've taken more than an hour for this session. So I'm going to close it. But before closing it, I want to say some remarks. So I hope you've perceived that from the grid perspective, there are many innovations taking place. And these innovations that they are taking place may disrupt your traditional businesses. So I hope that after this session, you are a little bit uneasy with yourself, and you look forward to the future and to the things that are happening. I also hope that you leave the session thinking that there are tons of opportunities, because the disruptions and the innovations that are taking place are going to change the markets, the way some of the markets are operated. And if you don't know how to go about it, well, talk to these guys. They've followed the path of scouting and looking at how to process and deal with innovations in the marketplace. So I thank you very much, all the panelists. I mean, IRENA does a fantastic job in forecasting also. So you have all these four guys that I'm sure that they are willing to respond to your questions with regards to innovation. Because one of the things that happens with innovators and people involved in innovation is they are happy to talk about what they are doing. So I wanted to thank you very much, the panel, and thank very much HAE for inviting us here, and Kostas Andriosopoulos again. And we close the session with an applause to our panelists. Thank you.